Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Hunter's Code, Book 3, by Yuri Vinokuroff and Oleg Sapphire, translated by Alex Merlin Williamson, narrated by Brian Telestai. Chapter 1.
May I come in, sir? Ah, Galaxius, do come in. What brings you here?
I need your help, sir.
Is that so?
The head of the Monster Slayer Center, Duke Vasily Petrovich Kuruliov, tore himself from the papers before him and raised his head.
Judging by the reports I've received, help is the last thing you need. Is Galaxius himself truly asking for aid?
Everyone needs help sometimes, sir.
True enough.
The old Slayer chuckled.
Would you like some tea?
Sure.
To my surprise, he didn't call in his secretary, but stood up himself, walked over to the big samovar, picked up a large cup, and filled it with aromatic tea. Then he smiled mysteriously.
Honey?
He asked. Please. I nodded again.
I'm afraid my honey isn't from Azure Bees, although it isn't bad either.
Mischief flashed in the old Class 2 Slayer's eyes. That caught me off guard.
Someone snitched, huh? Snitched? Oh, no, not at all.
He placed a large cup before me and a jar of transparent honey beside it.
Reported. It was a response team, after all. They are obliged to report such incidents.
I shrugged. They nearly killed me. At that, the old man laughed.
Somehow that seems unlikely to me. But yes, you acted by the book. Only Count Fyodorov has been whining ever since you took his gear away.
I can give it back if necessary, though there is one problem. My apartment was blown up. If the firemen find the sword, I'll give it back.
The old man's smile dropped.
Yes, I heard of your misfortune. My sympathies.
Thanks, I nodded. Actually, that's why I'm here.
The old man sat back in his chair and looked at me with interest.
I need to live in the center for a while.
Clear intrigue flickered in the old man's eyes.
How long is a little while?
Just until I solve certain, I faltered, difficulties.
The old man drummed his fingers on the table, his gaze fixed on me, apparently thinking something over.
You do understand that we aren't running a hotel here, yes?
I do, but I'm willing to pay,
and I don't need your money.
The Slayer interrupted me.
So it's a no?
I frowned.
I didn't say that. You are young and brash, but still a Slayer. Your reputation speaks for itself, and your potential...
The old man scratched his gray head.
Well, I can't even predict it myself, to be frank. That hasn't happened for a long time. Normally, I can see right through all you types. Will you tell me how you closed those rifts?
I leaned back and crossed my arms.
Sorry, no can do. If that's a condition of me staying here, I'll have to get gone. Oh, relax,
the center chief said, waving a hand.
Just an old man's curiosity. As for your stay here, you'll have to work it off.
How? Exactly? I pricked up my ears. I will assign several rifts to you. You will have to close them.
He saw me tense up.
Don't worry. I'm not planning to make a slave of you. Just 2 or 3 problematic rifts. On one condition, that you take others along with you. A group of slayers that I select.
Thinking about it, I already had to close them all the time anyway. So why not go with them, so they could see that I was just doing the same job they were? After all, if I always went alone, then they'd invent stories about some great gift that I was hiding. Instead, I could beat up some monsters side by side with them, and at the same time, get a boost to my karma. It wouldn't look right for me to agree too fast, though.
Can't I just do them alone?
I asked, keeping the scowl on my face.
I'd find that a lot simpler. I'm used to only having to look after my own ass.
No. This one is a condition of your stay. I consider it entirely reasonable. You can take it or leave it.
I nodded. I'd have to try hard to make sure I didn't get found out. But the old man was right. It was a reasonable condition.
Fine, then. I agree. But I need a few days first for a business trip. In the meantime, there's a girl that needs to stay here, and I'd like you to keep an eye on her.
Not a problem. We'll watch her like a hawk. Her room service check will be waiting for you when you get back. Ha ha.
The old man smiled at his own joke. Thank you, sir. I stood up and offered him my hand. Groaning, the old man shook it.
Come on, no need to rush off. Finish your tea, and let's just chat.
Well, what can I say? They set us up comfortably in the guest barracks for slayers. Unlike the regular barracks for new recruits, here there were individual rooms. Our small 2-room suite had just barely enough space for the both of us. But all that mattered was that we were inside the center. Doubtful that King could reach us here. Imperial oversight and all that. This place was unassailable and untouchable.
Learned anything?
I asked Anna, who was going through some papers.
Yep.
Schnoop didn't burn up absolutely everything. In one of the premises marked by Anna as an accountancy office, he was able to make off with a drawer of documents from the chief accountant. The department it was from was officially above board. King's legal businesses went through it, and they were what Anna was studying now.
I have 2 targets for you, the girl said. Here and here.
She tossed 2 folders to me. I sat down and took a look.
A pig farm and a slaughterhouse? Seriously, these are the best options?
Funnily enough, the slaughterhouse brings in 30% of his legal income, and the pig farm, 20%. And let me tell you, that means big numbers.
Is meat that expensive nowadays?
I chuckled.
Maybe we're in the wrong business. Should I go learn to be a farmer?
Not a bad idea, Anna smiled. But no. The numbers I saw can't possibly match what's really here. I have a rough knowledge of the meat market in the Empire. Basically, in order to provide that kind of income, that slaughterhouse would have to be 4 times larger and working around the clock, and the pig farm would have to be at least 10 times the current size. Something doesn't add up.
Right, I nodded. I'll take care of it.
I stared glumly at the last weapon I had left, the huge club, and scratched my head. I didn't like the idea of lugging that big thing around and buying more crap from Arkhip. Might as well throw my money away. The firemen still hadn't called me, probably still picking through the ruins. Maybe they'd find something there, but I couldn't be sure.
I sighed and hefted the huge club onto my shoulder, spending a little power to strengthen my body. I'd have to keep powering my body with energy while I carried it. But what can you do? A penny saved is a penny earned.
Epic outfit, Anna said,
grinning as she looked at me. I looked at myself in the mirror. All right, so the tip of the club was bigger than my head, and with the spine sticking out, maybe I did look a little comical.
Don't hate the player.
I waved the weapon a couple of times and accidentally knocked over the coat hanger by the door.
All right, I'm off. See you.
We were renting the property here, after all. It was all I needed to trash the place.
All right, good luck, Anna said. And be careful.
I left our room and headed down the corridor, then was met with a surprise at the porch. Helga, standing there with a thoughtful look on her face.
Hey there, beautiful,
I chuckled, watching with pleasure as the girl blushed at the innocent compliment.
Decided to move house, huh?
The girl asked.
Where's the hello, the hugs and kisses?
Helga ignored my fooling around.
I heard you didn't come here alone.
Oh, you have spies. I grinned at her.
Yeah, that's my colleague.
Colleague? The girl raised an eyebrow in surprise.
Well, yeah. Why, what did you think?
I thought she was a pros... Helga broke off.
Sorry. I'm rushed off my feet today.
Oh, no need to apologize, I shrugged. How have you been, anyway? I heard from Andre that you're planning on leaving. I don't know what your mysterious task was here, or what the hell you were doing here at all, but I get the picture your work is done. I'm surprised to see you still here, actually.
I've extended my business here. Helga said, thoughtfully.
Are you staying with us for long? She asked, as if in passing.
Depends how things go.
And where's that monstrosity from? She nodded towards the club.
Headed out to sell it?
Nah, decided to get a little exercise.
A rift?
Helga widened her eyes. Like this? I looked down at myself. All right, so my chainmail and arm guard were gone, and I had no throwing knives left. So I was standing there all smart, in my civilian suit, with a huge club over my shoulder. So what? Stylish, youthful, fashionable. Just right for raiding some rifts.
Want me to lend you some money?
Helga asked with a sympathetic frown.
Whoa there, girlfriend,
I laughed. Things aren't that bad yet. I'm not bankrupt. I have money, it's just that this, I swept a hand down my outfit, is more than enough for me now. After all, I have this beauty here on my team, too. I petted Carmel on the head. Helga's gaze softened at once.
Hey, little friend.
To my surprise, she came closer and stroked the panther's head before I had time to open my mouth. Wow, and she didn't even bite her hand off. I could see Carmel accepted her as a friend. What had they got up to for the panther to be so friendly with her?
Want me to come along with you?
Helga asked, again, as if as an afterthought.
Thanks, but not today.
The girl's gaze darkened a little.
Well, you know, your grandpa made me agree to a few raids, so if you pull some strings and something tells me you have them, then you can get yourself into my raid group.
Looking forward to seeing you there, I said with complete sincerity, and realized that it was true. The girl's eyes softened just a little.
Well, all right.
By the way, there's a surprisingly good bar here on grounds of the center. If you suddenly feel like taking a night out...
Her eyes darted toward the window where Anna was watching us.
Are you asking me on a date?
I narrowed my eyes.
Ugh, Galaxius, you're such a dumbass. You really know how to ruin everything.
Helga huffed angrily and turned on her heel and walked away.
Strange girl,
I chuckled. Come on, Furball. I nodded to Carmel, who was growling at me unkindly.
You are a dumbass,
I heard in my head.
Oh, you're talking again, huh?
I said.
Whatever.
Let's go. Time to play some dirty tricks on some bad guys. The first target for one of those dirty tricks was the pig farm. I couldn't see anything at all over its high walls. The place was like a fortress. On the other hand, Schnoop could see inside them just fine. I set off to the side and carefully looked at everything he showed me. Strange, but it really was a pig farm. The more Schnoop crept around, the greater my surprise. Just an ordinary pig farm. Pigs grunting in their sties. Sows feeding piglets. All clean. Nothing amiss. But when Schnoop got to the logistics center, matters took a turn. First of all, I saw that the logistics center was a kind of state within a state. It had two vehicles for loading, ordinary trucks at first glance. Judging by the thickness of the doors, they were armored at least as well as a center APC. They were partly filled with oinking and screeching pigs, and just now, they were in the process of loading. Schnoop crept further in.
Whoa! A stubborn pig was dragged into a cozy building, and the people sitting inside deftly packed up a jelly and stuffed it into the animal's mouth, forcing it to swallow. Then they put a small, barely noticeable stamp on its belly. After that, the pig was immediately sent out to be loaded up, then another, and another.
How much time do we have?
One of the packers asked, wiping his brow.
We've only just started. Plenty more to be done. Let's go for a smoke and get back to it.
The men walked out, past the beefy guards. And Schnoop immediately stuck his curious nose into the container standing nearby. One was full of white jellies, another of red. Ton of jellies. I chuckled.
Bring those here, my friend.
And bring them he did, though it took him several trips back and forth. After counting, I realized that I was richer by 243 white and 34 red jellies, the total worth of which at today's prices was almost 30,000 rubles. As I counted the loot again with a grin, the screech of an alarm split the air. Schnoop was frolicking nearby, and I winked to him.
That's all. No more need to go back there. We've done what we came to do. Now let's get out of here, fast.
A question kept spinning in my head. Why go to all that trouble to hide jellies? And then I remembered the destination of the cargo. The Khanate of the Grand Steppe. Right. A permanent enemy of the Eastern Empire, they had a habit of attacking the Empire's borders whenever their warlike ruler got in a mood. From what I remembered, it was forbidden to sell weapons to them. And jellies were a kind of weapon, too. Definitely a dual-purpose item, at best. They came under the ban, anyway. Whereas trading in foodstuffs was allowed. King had to be making a sizable profit on this contraband. Well, better leave the target in peace for now. Maybe I'd come back here again, and more than once or twice. I didn't bother calling a taxi, just walked. Who knows what connections King had, after all. And I knew I'd be suspect number one, considering the circumstances of the disappearing goods.
No need to make his job any easier. I just hailed a passing truck, and the trucker gladly gave Sir Slayer and his fine kitty a ride. The slaughterhouse was on the other side of Irkutsk. I asked him to drop me off in the city center, which he did, and refused to even take any money for it. Then I looked thoughtfully at the sack of jellies. Couldn't cart them around with me, and it wasn't an option to give them to Arkhip either. I could hand them in at the center, but maybe King had connections there too. An idea came into my head that we'd pulled off recently in the park. Schnoop, go search. We were in an old part of the city, and Schnoop crept down to where there were numerous tunnels underground. 15 minutes, and he found a dry tunnel segment covered with a rusty grate and just as rusty lock. Some service room for the local utilities. Didn't look like anyone had been down there in some time. After sending the sack of jellies there, I asked the little critter very politely to please, please remember where it was. I took a look around myself, taking note of the surroundings. I didn't want to end up like a dog who'd buried a bone and then forgotten where he'd put it. I'd have to start keeping bookmarks at this rate. Well, now for the slaughterhouse. And again, our examination began with an apparently real and straightforward business, a holding section into which the unfortunate cattle were driven to await the slaughter. Tiled sections, partly splattered in blood, partly already washed. Where was the catch here? No sooner did I ask that question than Schnoop found himself on the carcass cutting floor. What a strange cow. I asked Schnoop to get closer to it. It was almost twice the size of an ordinary cow and looked maybe 3 times as heavy. It also had 6 legs and horns that a bison could envy. As I watched, its skull was split open with a circular saw, and a white jelly was cut from the brain. That confirmed my suspicions. After that, they went on skillfully cutting up the carcass as if nothing was amiss. Oh, now this was starting to get interesting. Schnoop took our search further, and, of course, in a large, secure hangar, he found a rift. You clever bastard, King! 2 men happened to be walking out of the rift, and they looked nothing like slayers. Judging by their transparent rings, they were simple workers. The rings were only there to let them into the rift. They were bringing out the corpse of another cow on a cart. Rift farming, huh? I chuckled. Now that was something else. It was getting dark. Large spotlights switched on around the perimeter. Electric current ran up through the wire fence. People moved on watchtowers, aiming machine gun barrels in all directions. Still, I needed to get inside. I sent Schnoop out scouting again with a specific goal. This time, my interest lay in the substation that powered this whole complex. I sent 1 salamander that way, and 2 to the fighters' barracks, and asked them to kill themselves. A huge buzzing shock filled the air, and, unsurprisingly, all the lights shut off in the area. The only sources of light left were 2 merry blazes, one where the substation had stood, and another at the barracks. I ran up to the perimeter, filled my club with power, and slammed it into the wall. Shit. Overdid it a little. The whole section of wall fell in. I chuckled. This club wasn't as bad as it looked. Next, taking advantage of the panic, I just made a break for my target. The guards were weakly gifted, and I took them down without slowing. The idiots didn't even have infrared goggles in case they lost visibility. I didn't have any either, but I did have my infrared Schnoop instead, whose vision allowed me to see everywhere. We'd practiced it plenty in our past life. Yeah, it took extra energy. He sat on my shoulder, and I just switched to looking through his eyes. Ordinary workers were running all over the place. The rift was open, and I ran into it, and headlong into some fully equipped fake slayers, whose rings burned with a white light. Apparently, they were strong enough to kill the local mutant cows, and one of them held a sword with a pleasant greenish tint. As my schnoop would have said, "What?" I smiled and slammed my club into the chest of the closest as I ran. Fair credit, he had experience and had trained his gift well. He managed to power up his armor in time, and instead of exploding in a shower of blood, he flew back and fell down unconscious. The second one couldn't think of anything smarter to do than power up his body and attack me. A purple bolt flashed by my right side. Caramel flying into the unlucky gang member. They rolled away together. Before they stopped, the panther's claws were ripping through his armor. The first scream told me when his armor fell. A few seconds more, and the slayer stopped twitching. "You could work a little cleaner, you know," I said, frowning at Caramel, who walked off to one side and started licking her paws. Really, the man was torn to shreds. I carefully took off his belt and scabbard and sheathed the sword that Caramel had knocked away from him with her first hit. I was right. Karsk steel. True, it was on the short side. But beggars can't be choosers. Two white jellies, and that was all. I walked up to the second man, still stunned. He was still breathing, albeit lying unconscious. Looked like I'd broken the hell out of his ribs, and they pierced his lungs, judging by the bloody foam at his lips. The man was done for. Well, unless he got a good healer right away. But he wasn't going to. "Nothing personal, pal," I said with a chuckle, cutting his throat. His cheap alloy sword went into my bag, and I pulled the ring from his finger, which turned transparent after the death of its owner. I turned it over in my hand. Like I thought, no identifying number at all. This person wasn't enrolled in the center and didn't train there. This was purely King's personal army. I took two jellies from him, too, and carefully examined his equipment. Ordinary riveted leather armor. Armor for our world, with no special bonuses at all apart from the special stink. "Damn, boys, do you ever wash?" I grimaced, then climbed to my feet. I saw cows grazing in the distance and sighed heavily. I liked animals more than people. But I had no choice. Weighing both the swords in my hand, I smiled and just tied them to the back of my backpack, picking up my monstrous club again. Waving it a couple of times, I headed toward the herd. I wondered, would one hit be enough to take the head off one of those beasts? Better for them not to suffer, after all. I emerged from the rift as dirty as ever, bloodied, but entirely satisfied. I'd played my dirty trick on the bad guys, closed a rift, and even gotten some souls, even if I did have to slice up some animals in the process. The zone had been child's play. All I had to do was kill all the monsters, which I did. Schnoop showed me that nobody was waiting for me outside. They must have been busy with the chaos in the slaughterhouse. I walked out and smiled. Then I took out a marker with my number on it, drew a happy smiley face on the label, and stuck it into the ground outside the rift. Dusting off my hands, I quickly left the slaughterhouse, now far less financially viable than it was before. Right, Anna was set up and under watch, and I had kicked up the hornet's nest. Now I had to give things time to settle down. And in the meantime, hello, mysterious empire of the rising sun. King's bunker. King raged and stormed. He had nearly torn apart his observation room. Luckily, he stopped himself in time. That equipment was damn expensive. Instead, he tore apart the adjoining recreation room. Around him were the smashed remains of the billiard table and a multitude of bottles of expensive alcohol.
"Find him!" he shouted. "Find that son of a bitch and kill him!"
"But he's in the Monster Slayer Center, boss."
"I don't give a rat's ass. Storm the place. Blow it all to hell."
"Ivan Ivanovich, do you really want to declare war on the Empire?" Of course, King didn't want that. He was just angry. That bastard had got him again.
"Place guards around the center. Don't let a single one of those sons of bitches get by us. As soon as he shows up there, report to me at once. Send all our forces there."
King's phone beeped. He glanced at it, and his face darkened.
"Damn it! Stand them down!"
"Sorry, Ivan Ivanovich. Stand down... who?"
"All of them."
King looked at the photo he'd been sent. In the background was a sandy beach. In the foreground, a billboard. "Welcome to Odaiba Beach." And, in the snow-white sand, a stick or finger had written the number 2, colon, and then the number 1. Chapter 2. I heard about the Empire of the Rising Sun for the first time in my early childhood, when I watched anime-style cartoons on the TV. I remembered that the large-eyed girls and boys had made me laugh then. I asked my tutor, was this some special human race with the largest eyes in the world? As it turned out, it was the other way around. That was the first strangeness I discovered from the Empire of the Rising Sun. Then, when I grew up and started training, I met a narrow-eyed master from the Japanese Empire who easily took down 3 of our own masters in an exhibition match. I also remembered that my father had been very disappointed. In the end, he paid some enormous sum of money for the Japanese visitor to train up his personal bodyguards. I had always been interested in power since I was a young boy, as soon as I recognized myself in this body, and in my past life, too. Human power, first of all. Early on, I moved from kids' books to a focused study of the history of the Earth. That's when I learned about the epicenters and the fact that there were several of them on the planet. In Eurasia, one was in the Eastern Empire, and the other just so happened to be in the Empire of the Rising Sun. And although the Imperials had full control over their own epicenter, the Japanese had a real nightmare to deal with. After all, it's hard to control something several miles under the water. That's right. The Japanese epicenter, as it was called for simplicity, was over 100 miles from the eastern shore of the Japanese archipelago. And it was based on this very epicenter that the scientists of the world learned just where the uncontrolled development of unclosed rifts could lead. At first, from what I understand, there were ordinary rifts there, and all the sweet little critters that emerged from them died instantly, crushed by the pressure of the profound depths. Some of them even floated up to the surface when they didn't get eaten by the beasts of the deep first. For some time, there were even fishermen toiling above the Japanese epicenter, catching the lightly chewed corpses of rift beasts. From what I could tell, in some ways, they really did have a tougher time of it than the EE. You have to reach a rift somehow, but the waters were teeming with beasts. All they could do was guard the coastline. And then, it seemed, the rifts evolved, started to spew out beasts that could breathe and live under the water. Problems began with shipping. Monsters attacking civilian ships, armed escorts had to be sent out. But it didn't stop there. After some time, either the beasts started to mutate here, or they changed in their source world of the rifts.
The scientists didn't have a clear answer either way. In any case, beasts began to appear who successfully left the rifts and reached the shores of the Empire of the Rising Sun, since it was the closest land. They crawled out onto the shore and started making life interesting for the inhabitants. On top of that, the bastards evolved to be even larger. Huge mountains of flesh started slithering onto the shore. The Japanese had to go to quite some effort to defeat them. I recalled that I even got a hold of a comic about Godzilla in my childhood. That was what they called the first beast that suddenly appeared on the unprotected shores of Tokyo Bay. So many lives were lost then. Currently, the entire east of the empire was a multi-tiered defensive net, complete with artillery and missile platforms, aircraft, and endless garrisons. Even the global community appreciated the usefulness of the Rising Sun. After all, if the monsters destroyed the Japanese islands, they would continue on to Korea, the Dragon Empire, and the Eastern Empire. Accordingly, the strongest guarantor countries wrote a law on the neutrality of the Empire of the Rising Sun. It particularly concerned their neighbor Koreans, who had constant squabbles with them. When the cunning Koreans once again took advantage of a mass attack by rift monsters on the eastern shore to mobilize their own army and attack the Japanese in the flank, the Pacific Imperial Fleet made it abundantly clear that it would not stand for it, and the dragons took advantage of the commotion to nibble away at the northern borders of Korea. The Korean Empire had caused no more trouble since then, and the Empire of the Rising Sun had unwittingly become something of a permanent sword and shield of the eastern borders of Eurasia. It was no wonder that through all of this, the society's highest values were valor and bravery, and the education of children was aimed exclusively at the martial sciences. As expected, Dolgorukova chose the most expensive hotel in Kyoto, Celestial City, and immediately rushed off to tend to her own affairs. Reconnaissance work, as she put it. I didn't stay in the room for long, checking my smartphone and studying where I could go. I drew up a plan. "Reception?" I asked, dialing a number on the room phone, which only had Japanese characters on it. I spoke in English, and when I got a positive answer on the third try, I celebrated. "Send lunch for two up to my room, please. Meat and seafood." Praise be that they didn't ask me to be more specific. Carmel was pleased with the delicious marbled steak they brought up for her. After eating, I went to take a look at the capital of fierce, narrow-eyed warriors. The coastline in Kyoto looked incredible. With my own eyes, I could now see what I'd seen so much of online, read so much about. The sheer size of the coastal batteries was astounding. They were larger than any other naval cannons in existence, and made to order. And not far away stood the Japanese fleet at anchor in the bay, mostly consisting of small destroyers bristling with depth charges. Patrol flotillas constantly kept watch between the islands and the epicenter. In the case of an early detection of monsters, the entire standby fleet moved out to the signal and dropped mines down on the monsters' heads. "What's up?" I looked at Carmel, who was pointing a paw at a ship. She looked at me with her cunning eyes. "Meow." I sighed heavily. "No, they won't take us fishing with them." There was a fish restaurant not far from us, and the whole pier smelled of fish. We were heading right towards it. A little further out, there were a few battleships and cruisers sitting at anchor, but their task was to deal with monsters not far from the shoreline, in case any of them managed to reach the shallows or, God forbid, the shore itself. The choice of smaller destroyers wasn't by chance. Sometimes it happened that a monster attacked ships, and then what mattered most was maneuverability, or, if they were destroyed, then low cost. Losses are unavoidable in any war. If the general has a way of minimizing them, he uses it. Most surprisingly of all, life in the city went on as normal behind all these fearsome fortified armaments. The small sandy beach was filled with people relaxing at their ease. The locals must have been used to the situation here. Or maybe they'd just gotten tired of being afraid. The panther sniffed the air a couple more times, then went nuts. What could I do? My pet was a greedy guts. No choice. We had to stop in the restaurant. After some fish and a 700-ruble bill, I went to the beach and sent a message to King. I paid by card, so I didn't have to carry the local currency. And with the light sensation of a debt repaid, I decided to take a walk through the city, a little embarrassed by the constant bows I was getting from random passers-by. At first, I didn't understand what that was about, and then I realized that the ordinary nod of greeting from the people who, for some reason, didn't see my ring was very different from the waist-deep bow of those who did see it. Seemed like they had more respect for slayers here than back home. Makes sense. Here in the Empire of the Rising Sun, the life of the common folk depended entirely on the mastery of the monster slayers. Despite the fact that the army and navy did most of the work, it was groups of slayers who organized the defenses and the ultimate destruction of the monsters. I didn't know what was going on with my cat today, but she got hungry again, and this time she was staring wide-eyed at some rolls that a young Japanese man with long, thin whiskers was making right in a restaurant window. "You'll get fat at this rate, and I'll never be able to find a boy cat for you," I said, shaking my head at her. As I walked into the Japanese restaurant, I was surprised again. Firstly, by the fact that the owner rushed up to greet me personally, bowing almost double. And secondly, that he spoke in perfect Eastern Imperial and told me what an honor it was to welcome a monster slayer. And, of course, it would be his pleasure to treat me to his finest dishes for free. He really messed up there. Carmel purred in satisfaction. At the sight of her, the owner began to stammer and, with eyes nearly bursting out of his sockets, informed me that his words extended to my pet also. I didn't refuse, and after an hour of gorging ourselves on all-you-can-eat fresh fish, Carmel and I burst out of the restaurant like two stuffed geese. In the doorway stood the smiling owner with his two wives, waving us goodbye and nodding like bobbleheads as we went. Strange folks. "Surprising culture, but I like it," I said, waving a hand. The hand with my ring on it. Three taxis nearly caused an accident, and their drivers almost came to blows over the right to take me where I wanted to go. And unlike the taxi drivers in Irkutsk, these ones didn't seem bothered at all by the presence of Carmel. Just beckoned her into the broad back seat. "Claws away," I muttered, earning myself a reproachful glance before the panther jumped softly in and sat down. Carmel wore a fancy blue collar that Anna had found for her somewhere, and put it on herself. I wouldn't have risked it. They really were becoming friends. Anna got the collar for one simple reason. Unlike me, she had studied the traditions and rules of my destination. In the Empire of the Rising Sun, people have a very negative perception of rift beasts, which have taken the lives of many of their friends and family. That meant that someone might attack Carmel if she wasn't wearing a collar. Any attacker would be digging his own grave, of course, but I don't need that kind of trouble. Only the gifted would realize that it was just an ordinary collar. But those same gifted would also recognize that since it was ordinary, there must be a reason for it. And for normal people, the panther would look just as safe as if she were wearing a subjugation collar. While we flew in on the plane, an army plane, actually, which the Duchess somehow organized, since only the military risk flying close to the epicenter, Dolgorukova slept for most of the journey. She had been through a tough rift the day before, the closing of which discharged her yearly duties. As for me,
I spent the journey looking up places of interest to me, including weapons stores. The bladed weapons of the Empire of the Rising Sun were famous throughout the world. Europeans found them a little tough to use because of the unfamiliar balance. But for me, with all my past experience, it didn't make any difference what I waved around. So it was time to go see what the local craftsmen had to offer. Judging by the information online, the first store the taxi driver took me to belonged to a noble family with an interesting gift for working with metal. Their craftsmen had been making the best swords in the empire for hundreds of years. I was led in by a guard who bowed deeply and emanated an easy aura of power of, at least, veteran rank. The guard's impassive face was smooth as stone. Actually, no. The edge of his trained eye twitched when it landed on the short sword I'd looted from that gangster. Apparently, that quick twitch of an eye was all the disdain the dispassionate guard was allowed to show. "Sorry, buddy. I gotta make do." I stepped inside. Unexpected. A huge hall, comfortable seats and a waiting area, multiple cute saleswomen who darted to me like moths to a flame, and in total, 12 different types of weapons were on display in the room, which had to be over 2,000 square feet. Was this place really a store? More like a museum. The girls started twittering right away. I shot them a friendly smile and said clearly, "East Imperial, English, German, or Italian, please." At that point, one of them started to speak Imperial, the second German, the third Italian, and the fourth English. "Wow, the full set." I smiled. Although I suspected that each of them knew all those languages, just part of the job. On top of that, they looked fine as hell. Honestly, I tried not to think of how long it had been since my last sexual encounter. But soon, as fat old Mac used to joke, it would start pouring out of my ears. This place seemed like a top-class business, and the girls were top-class, too. Short skirts, stockings, neat blouses. I frowned. What did they remind me of? Right. Those dumb anime comics. The girls looked like this in those, too. Only these ones had normal eyes, like Japanese girls should have.
"What would the gentleman like to see? What would the gentleman like to buy?"
I interrupted them. "All right, you and you stay here. The rest of you, thank you." The other girls bowed obediently and left us in peace. The other two seemed to be indescribably pleased at my choice. But I had made it quite simply. I just chose the ones with the biggest tits. I mean, breasts. Damn spermatoxicosis. The gentleman would like to take a look around first.
"What type of weapons is the gentleman interested in?"
"Let's start with the swords." I nodded.
"Please follow me, sir,"
one of the girls tittered. And the second,
"Would you like some tea or coffee, sir? Perhaps champagne?"
"Sir, we'll definitely take you up on your offer later," I chuckled. "But first, the weapons." We walked up to the first pedestal.
"A stunning katana crafted by,"
the girl said, launching into a long, rehearsed speech. But I just stood frozen in astonishment. The katana really was impressive. I could feel the aura of power it gave off. When an inanimate object can hold power on its own, that shows it to be the work of a master of the highest art. I narrowed my eyes and looked closer at the weapon's aura. It burned particularly brightly in a few places around the pommel and blade, right where there were runes of power inscribed, placed and powered by an unknown master. Even if I filled myself with jellies and poured all my energy into the thing, there was no way I'd damage it. Not unless I trained for years first. I scratched the back of my head, catching myself thinking of how to break the weapon.
I lowered my eyes to the price tag. There was a description written in all the languages I'd listed, and more. And next to it was a price in the national currency. The sword was worth 1.5 million imperial rubles. I wish I could say it was overpriced, but looking at the blade again, I decided the price was fair. I'd never seen a sword like it before. Even Arkhip's store, with its exclusive items, didn't approach these prices to within even a million. Maybe there was a store like this one somewhere in St. Petersburg, but I doubted it. May I? I reached out a hand. Obviously, I wouldn't have enough money for it anytime soon, but it looked so enticing.
Of course, sir.
The girl put on some delicate silk gloves, carefully took it off the pedestal, and handed it to me. Energy surged from the sword. I'd definitely never seen anything like it in this world. That was for sure. What did this mean? The sword itself was a kind of battery that could recharge its owner. Now that's what I call a blade.
The gentleman may walk this way.
The girl bowed again and pointed to a specially marked off area with a little free space and no breakable objects at all. Man's love for weaponry can never be understood. I couldn't deny myself the pleasure. I took a combat stance and performed a few moves. The sword sang in my hands. The thought suddenly occurred to me. Could I just run out of here and take this amazing sword with me? I pushed down the urge and embarrassment. Maybe I could send Schnoop in to steal it. No. The girl switched off some clearly complicated alarm system before she touched the blade. And secondly, that would be a little... Hell, it would be very, very wrong. You can't just steal a weapon like that. A weapon like that has to either be bought or won in battle. I liked the second option more. I needed to find some local Japanese guy and challenge him to a duel. Ha ha. Go Galaxius. I performed some pirouettes thoughtfully, enjoying the whistle of the blade. As I reached the end of the combo, I froze, surprised to hear someone clapping. I turned and saw an old, but still strong, Japanese man walking toward me unhurriedly. All the girls bowed low at the sight of him. I swore to myself, catching myself thinking that I'd just shown off everything I should be keeping hidden. Feeling such a fine weapon in my hands, I'd let my power go to increase my speed. From the outside, I must have looked like a blur in the air. God damn it, Xander. Keep a low profile.
Yoshito Nakamura.
The man gave me a brief nod. Upon his finger burned a family signet ring with an unfamiliar symbol on it that said nothing to me. But the name said a lot. It was the name of the ancient family to whom this store belonged. He also wore a slayer ring. It shimmered with a blinding blue light, showing his class. 2. A powerful old man. Alexander Galaxius.
Very pleased to meet you.
The old Japanese man nodded again, slowly.
And I am very surprised to see such perfect technique with a katana from such a young slayer. Even Slayer 5th class, with all due respect for you, is a little fast for your age, young man.
Well, I'm very talented, you know, I said, coughing and not knowing what to do. Offer to shake his hand, or... In the end, I just nodded briefly back at him. There was no way I could tell by the old man's face whether I'd broken the rules. I'd heard the Japanese were sticklers for decorum, but I just didn't know the details.
Allow me to ask you a question, young man.
The old man bowed his head slightly. Please do.
Where did you learn those techniques? Clearly, not here in our country. I would have heard of such a prodigy. And I also know that, in the past 10 years, there have been just 3 great magisters of such a level outside the bounds of our empire. I wonder which of them trained you, and doubtless spent several years of their life in so doing.
Who trained me? Well, I've had a few teachers, I said honestly. Old Mac probably tried the hardest with me, and Grandmaster Wolf taught me the basics.
The Japanese man frowned. I know neither of those names.
It was all far away from here, and they weren't Japanese.
Then that is even more surprising, the old man said. You did not mention your title. Are you from the Eastern Empire? A count? A duke?
No, I'm just a baron.
At that, the wise old man twitched an eyelid. How very strange, he muttered. I even started to feel a little bad for him.
Like I said, Sir Nakamura, I am very talented, and I just don't have the money for this kind of weapon. Doubt I will have it any time soon. I smiled. Forgive me. I couldn't resist.
The weapon is intended for human hands. Skilled human hands. Whereas you have the hands of a virtuoso. You have done me honor by visiting my humble store.
At this, the old man suddenly gave me a deep bow. I handed the sword to the girl, who bowed also as she took it from me before walking away. With your permission, I'd like to look at more of your weapons, I said. I hadn't had this much fun in a long time.
I will gladly show you them all personally.
The old man smiled, sending the girls away with a motion of his brow.
After all, money can always be made, and far faster than mastery.
I chuckled. The old slayer was right. No doubt about that. Chapter 3. The old man was right, and I liked his thinking. Money really can always be made. I've never chased it. I've always just known. Money will come, and that's that. It's just a tool for achieving power and knowledge of the self, and it can help me feel better. I had seen people in my past life who believed that the path of power lay in the exploration of asceticism. Idiots. I came back from all manner of tough battles knowing that a tasty breakfast and warm women were waiting for me. But them? They went back to their cave to eat porridge with no sugar and sleep on a hard stone floor. And they really did like all that. But I never saw much power in them. There was no ascetics among hunters. We were taught maximalism and, in some sense, arrogance. A hunter has to show people their potential and what their path can lead to. How can we attract new recruits otherwise? Ha ha! What's that sword? I asked, seeing an interesting bluish blade.
That is the eye of the princess, he answered, pride clear in his eyes as he beheld the blade. My son created it in honor of a girl who got away from him. One of his first works of those that may be considered successful.
With his permission, I took it in hand and appreciated it for myself. A good blade, no doubt about that. And a hefty price, too, at 750,000 rubles. I had a decent conversation with the Japanese man, and we discussed several subjects. I didn't even know what made him so interested in me. Maybe he was just bored, or my technique really did impress him. I don't think I showed him anything all that special. I couldn't have. If I started working miracles, then my body just wouldn't withstand it. Sure, if I had my seals, and a lot of them, then I really would show him. If only. I could sense power from the old man, too. If he wanted to kill me, it would be a fight to the death. I'd have to use everything I had, and even then, there was no guarantee that I'd survive, even if I won. Better odds of running away.
"Take a look at this weapon," he said, leading me to a distant stand. "What do you think of it?"
It seemed he'd decided that some greatly respected master had taught me after all. I picked up the weapon and tried to sense it. With my eyes closed, I ran my fingers along the blade and started to charge it with my energy, feeling out its properties. I think that I shouldn't even touch such a weapon, I told him truthfully. He laughed.
Why not?
Too tempting to sell everything I own just to buy it, I answered, honestly. True, it isn't perfect. I don't know what the flaw is exactly, but there is one. When you sell this blade, I'll let down its owner, and then he or his family will come to you and complain.
Is that so?
He rubbed his chin thoughtfully. This time I didn't answer with the truth. I knew just fine what the problem was, but I couldn't tell him. This blade was alive. The hunters made blades like this, sealing the souls of very powerful monsters inside weapons and armor. It was considered the height of craftsmanship. But there was one nuance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.